Greetings, everybody. This is April 23rd, 2016. It's about 9 p.m., I guess, Eastern Standard Time. It's Saturday, thus there are no futures out yet, so I should have changed the date, but I never do these on Saturday, so I wasn't actually thinking. My email address, if you need to contact me, is hgsidoc@gmail.com. This is my weekend review, and I titled it The Question of How Much Longer Is there in this junk off the bottom led rally. If you don't believe this is junk off the bottom, then you haven't been listening to me and buying TCK and FCX and X and energy stocks that I've been talking about over the last 6 weeks. It's sort of been a gift, to put it mildly. Not me to you, but the market to all of us. Let's take a look and see what we got. Disclaimer, as always, is for education purposes only. Any recommendations are in the spirit of education and not investment advice. I'm a doctor, not a broker. Most physicians lose money with their investments, so keep any advice that I give you in the context of that comment. I am not affiliated with any software vendors or trading companies. Tools I demonstrate are those that I use in my daily trading, and I have paid for all the tools I demonstrate. No one pays me anything to talk about their product. Happy to take donations, but no one does to date. Trading involves risks, and you alone are solely responsible for any investment decisions you make. I'd like to always start with this slide, because I think it's important to pay thanks to those folks that have helped you succeed. On the left is my world to cancel him. Started with William O'Neill, taken to another degree by Morales and Catcher, made electronic and improved by O'Neill and Brown using HTSI software. And this is George Lee. I don't include him with canceling. He's just a great trader, friend of mine, and teacher in Canada, my favorite Canadian. And I married those principles, which may or may not be, at least the canceling, what's working best right now, with what I've learned from John Person, also a friend, mentor, teacher, lecturer, software developer, who's written some great books about the market, who I've been using his indicator package for a long time, Trade Navigator, and then more recently TradeStation, and we formed a user group called Pug Together. I actually had a Pug when I was growing up. And then Van Tharp in the upper right-hand corner is sort of the guide of position size and money management. It doesn't matter what style of trading you do and how good you are at picking stocks and market timing. If you don't know how to manage your money, you'll lose. I buy way too many programs. My desktops are littered by programs that I never use, but there are certain things that I find indispensable. I need a trading platform. TradeStation, Thinkorswim are great. They're both essentially free if you put in a decent size account. Genesis Trade Navigator, I think, is the best charting platform and the most customizable and flexible, but it requires purchasing data or linking it to your trading platform or your trading account. And it also costs $1,000 and up on an annual basis to operate, which most people, I think, in the land of free platforms from their broker may or may not do. But I love the product, which is why I have it. For analysis, it's HGSI and EdgeRater, seasonality with a number of different programs. I've paid for all of them. I use all of them and various websites. I started doing these programs as sort of a volunteer, unpaid marketer, support person, and basic cheerleader for HGSI software. Here is the website. If you're not a user, give it a try. I don't ask to be paid for these. I don't ask for anything in return. I do these because I like to give back. And I get nothing if you subscribe to HGSI, except I do get something real big, which I'll mention. You can get a free trial without a credit card if you punch right there. If you go up to investing strategies and drop down, you can see a number of things that I've done. And this is Gil Morales from Morales and Catcher fame. What do I get out of it? Simple. It's the most important program that I use today. And it has a modest sized user base. And every time somebody else signs up, we get another user. Another user equals revenue to the company, equals continued improvements in existence of the company. So the more the merrier, that's why I do this. Plus, I like George Roberts, who's the proprietor. I mentioned John several times already. You'll hear about how I use his things as we go. John is, you know, I play this on TV. I'm joking when I say on TV. I mean, I'm a doctor, and I've got no formal business training. I have been trading for over 20 years, and in the healthcare field, I've become an educator as well. So I married my enjoyment of education and being at the podium with my love of the markets. John's been trading since I was in residency program back to the 80s. He trades mostly stock options, and futures. I've seen him talk Forex, but I think he likes to use the currency futures instead. He does several, but not many, educational events throughout the year. And this is his big fall meeting. It's September 24th, 25th, and 26th. Three-day meeting in where we live in Palm Beach Gardens, which is a beautiful area at a very nice Hilton Garden Inn. As you could see, it's $1,478 without the hotel. And those that sign up early, I believe there's still an opportunity to get two free nights at the hotel. I've paid for this meeting several times. Now I get to speak at it, so I don't have to pay. I'd still pay if they made me. It's a great meeting. I learn every time I hear him talk. Now, it's not an HGSI meeting, and as most of you are aware, or many of you are aware, the annual October and March PV HGSI meetings are not being held this year. So I've decided that I will hold an HGSI meeting on September 23rd. This is the day before John's event. And unlike my prior two or three day meetings, I will be doing this by myself, which allows me to control costs. And it'll be a full day. And I'm anticipating $400, including lunch. If you're attending John's and you're paid attendee to John's program, I'll knock off $100 as sort of an inducement, legal inducement, to get you to come to John's meeting. As it says there, I anticipate having a small role in John's meeting. Therefore, the HGSI content will be presented on the 23rd. As always, where are we in this market? This is the market that just doesn't stop. We've had over a 20% move off the bottom, as you'll see. This week, the Russell finally broke above its moving averages. The bad news is the NASDAQ 100 seems to want to die. So we'll be looking at this and trying to understand. And it may be that this is actually going on, but what's happening is instead of the market rolling over, we're just getting fairly voracious market rotation. And I hope you own some of that junk off the bottom because it's amazing how much they've moved. Your market approach has to change with the cycle. You know, it's hard for me to tell you where we are because if you ask me where we are, if we're healthcare stocks, I think we're here. I think biotech's about to roll. And therefore, one of my picks of the week is a biotech play. I think energy stocks are over there. Gosh, after Friday, I think technology's sitting up here. We've got Apple, Facebook, and Amazon earnings around the corner. We'll see whether it gets us back going up or they're coming back down. Gold has had a huge run. I think gold might be sitting up there as well and perhaps at risk of giving something back. Utilities rolled over, firmed up at the end of the week. So we're seeing pretty profound rotation, which I'll show you more evidence of as we go further. So speaking of market rotation, this is a simple shot that I do in TradeStation. Part of John's package, and I can just look at this and see where strength and weakness was. Sorry, my TradeStation's scanning in the background, so that's why these things are popping up. Strength, utilities. Strength, financials. Strength, energy. Weakness, technology. Weakness, consumer discretionary. Weakness, gold miners, home builders. Social media, foreign markets. Transports mixed, planes down, trucks and trains up. So this was a very mixed market where there's areas of just tons of green and you balance that off by areas with tons of red. Very quickly, let's look at daily, weekly, and monthly. These are snapshots of one of the screens that's up constantly in my trading room. And this is from Thinkorswim, and it's got the E-minis in the upper left, the NQs in the middle, the YMs in the right, the TFs, or the Russell futures, in the lower left, the VX futures, volatility futures, and we've got the dollar. So on a daily basis, we can see a big move off the bottom. We can see the 50-day moving average here is now crossing the 200 on the daily. I think that's called the golden cross on the E-minis. It's about to cross on the NQs. We'll see if it gets there. And we've had the golden cross on the YMs. I mentioned we finally got the Russells to blast through. Last weekend, we talked about them facing resistance here, and it held for 3 or 4 days, and they blasted up on Monday and got across the descending 200-day moving average. All of these still look bullish. The only one that is most worrisome, testing down on the 200-day moving average, and we'll look at it much more, is the NASDAQ 100. The VIX is bouncing around near its bottom, although it did move up some this week. And the dollar, we'll see in a better picture, started to creep up a little as well. When I look to the weeklies, you can start to see the story of the top coming in over the summer, and that we still have not taken out our summer highs. VIX remains quite low, and the dollar, you can see the green top or bottoming tail there. The bottom dollar actually moved up this week. And if we take it back even further to monthly, just another view that just shows how, one, how we pull back to moving averages. This is a 50 monthly, so that's a 1500 daily, and bounced pretty big pullbacks, bigger here on the YM and on the TFs. And on the monthly chart, we can see the VIX is low and the dollar, although it's come down quite a bit over the last several months, is still much higher than it was during the heart of quantitative easing. And just one more view, and this is daily on the first row. This is different than normally. Weekly in the middle, monthly on the bottom. I took off 60 minutes and added monthly. E-minis, NASDAQ futures, at least NASDAQ 100, Russell futures, NYSE, and Dow futures. So the point here I wanted to show you is that everything looks great except the NASDAQ 100 futures, which have rolled over on the daily. Everything's still in a buy signal on the weekly. And on the monthly, the NASDAQ looks like it's still in a sell signal. Other than that, everybody's in a buy signal, at least the NASDAQ 100. So I like to do the same, I call it for color, evaluation every time I look at the market. I am a creature of habit. My wife and I go to the same 3 restaurants every week. I'm kidding, but you know what? I'm not really kidding. Once I get comfortable with something, I typically stick with it. So I like to look at interest rates. Why? Because I know that when rates are falling, it's good for REITs, MLPs, utilities, dividend payers, and home builders. When rates start to increase, banks and insurers, especially the regionals. So they trickled higher. The white for all of these analysis will be this, what we're looking at. The yellow is the S&P, and then I've got some moving averages, which in most cases are irrelevant. So the interest rates trickled up. We're off the lows from earlier this year or late last year. So I guess it's because we're having less easing than the rest of the world, which is not the same as tightening. Maybe that will drive rates higher. You look at the AD lines in white, you can't see a differentiation, except suffice it to say that both the AD line, the 2000 and the Russell 1000 are moving back to their highs. And in fact, on the Russell 1000, which are the larger stocks, the AD line is at an all-time high. The small stocks led the market lower. Their AD lines led the market lower. And they're lagging a little bit, but they're getting close to their highs as well. How many stocks are above the 200 and 400-day moving average? You could see we got to the point where we had a fairly profound number of stocks, 80, 90%, were below their 200-day moving average, and we are rocketing up here. Not quite to the point where we think the market has to turn around on the intermediate term, but on the short term, we're up in the 80 percentile of stocks above the 40-day SMA. When you get to these heights, you usually get some easement of the rally. So short term, a little bit overbought, not necessarily on the more intermediate or longer term. If you look at it purely as 1 month of new highs versus new lows, we're up here, which is about as strong as we get. And again, more evidence that short term we've become overbought. Now, the McClellan is not acting like it's overbought or oversold. It's kind of in the middle. Looks like it's plus 60 something. So it's telling me that we're not necessarily at an extreme. Extremes are important. I make most of my money at extremes because those are easiest to tell what's going to happen. We're in the middle there. The buckets, something also looking at extreme. I look to two things: what percent of stocks in the S&P 1500 are above their midline and their Bollinger bands, and you could see that we're maintaining over 70%. This is a week ago on the right, this is this week on the left. And you could see that we have a number of stocks, 10% here and about 8% last week above the Bollinger band. This is not exuberance. It's leaning towards overbought. But when I start to see 20 or 30% of stocks outside their upper band, I get a little bit more concerned. The Hindenburg omen is a mythical, mathematical, hypothetical, believe it or don't believe it, signal which seems to occur before most major meltdowns. It's occurred before every crash in the last 50 years, although we didn't get one in May. But since we're most back to the May heights, maybe it's because it was more of a bull market correction and not a bear. And it signifies when the professionals are getting out of the market and we're just getting in. And it's characterized by a lot of volatility. Moving averages on the indexes are going up. The McClellan is dropping. And there's a lot of both new highs and new lows, sort of symbolizing the exchange of shares. When all of the signals fire, you get a Hindenburg, and we have no signals firing or one signal now, so nowhere close to a Hindenburg. This is the Woody indicator. Green is a time that you're bullish, red, you're bearish. It's only in this column of the Woody indicator here. And you'll notice that back in beginning of April, we had a number of kahunas. Back in February 12th, we also had a bunch of kahunas. That's in blue, which is a big move to the upside, red to the downside. And that was when this market turned around. In fact, we'll look at performance from February 11th to give you an idea of why, say, this is a junk off the bottom market. The only thing worrisome here is we had sort of the proverbial shot across the bow of the bulls. We're on the NASDAQ 100. We had a kahuna to the downside on Friday. Not enough to switch anything out of green and yellow. There's no red on the Woody indicator, but I'm just putting it out there that the risk might be increasing. I like to look at the canaries to give me a sense of what some of these big stocks are doing. These are all major components of the NASDAQ 100. They're listed here. Google blew up on earnings. Netflix blew up on earnings. Facebook blew up on a report that their advertising slowing down. And you could see they pulled back and had a doji form on the 200-day moving average. Clearly a major point of support and decision-making. It'll be interesting to see if Amazon and Facebook and Apple earnings can lift us up, or if those earnings are bad, are we destined for some type of a retest down here, which would be a pretty big drop. We'll look more at the NASDAQ 100. The leaders, these are the leaders that I picked about 4 weeks, 3.5 weeks on March 6th after this rally started. And once I realized who the leaders were coming off the bottom, what I wanted to do was create an index in HGSI of these leaders to give me a sense of when it was time to fold up the tents. It's getting close to time to fold up the tents. We have stalled a pullback on the 50. A strong week this week, it'll bounce and we'll continue this bull market. Right now, you have to be nervous. Now, what could cause this to collapse on the leaders? It could be an overall change in the market. There's quite a few industry groups represented there, but there could be market rotations into the energy stocks and the bank stocks that may not be well represented. So you could have them roll over, not just because of a general market decline. You could also get them to roll over because of rotation. I track a lot of other sources. One of my sources that's pretty well-known newsletter writer about predicting bear markets has softened their position. This is another one. This is Lowry. They've been really good at calling the bears. And, you know, I have my daughter's boyfriend works for them. And we spent a lot of time talking about why is the market rallying and yet the selling pressure in red is higher than the buying pressure. And that suggests to me that we may just be having a robust but still a bear market rally. And we will see. So I told you junk off the bottom. I think I showed you this last week. It just gets even better. What is this telling me? It's telling me that since the market bottom on February 11th through the close on Friday, that stocks with the lowest ERG outperformed. This is the opposite of what you expect. Now, I normally ignore the tail and the head because the number of stocks in these groups are small, but even eliminating the tail and the head, you got a clear curve supporting that the lower the ERG, the higher the performance. What does ERG stand for? It stands for EPS rank, relative strength rank, and group rank. So what it shows me is that EPS rank versus gain, the lowest earnings per share rank outperformed everybody else. The lowest relative strength on February 11th outperformed everywhere else. The lower group ranks outperformed, and those stocks that were distributing on February 11th outperformed. The boxes are all over the place with no clear pattern. Box 1, 2, and 7 always outperform in a good market. But I think the big, you know, I don't measure stocks that have no earnings in the boxes. So what's the explanation here? Explanation is that this has been junk off the bottom. The steels, the ores, the gold, the energy, the miners, the copper players, the things that have been dead for a couple of years have started to stir. Those of you who are pure can slimmers that have noticed it's hard to make a big killing in this market, you're playing the wrong tools. I'm a can slimmer at heart, but when earnings per share doesn't matter, when relative strength is negative, it was against you, it's hard to win in a can slim stock. News this week, this is a busy week. Plenty of news, more important, look at all those earnings. So I will say this one more time. This is my quote. If somebody else made it, God bless them. I don't know, I didn't copy this. It is a judgment call to hold stocks over earnings dates. It is bad judgment to not know when your stock's earnings date is scheduled. That's a list. There are lists in many different places, earnings.com. This is from Livett Brothers. You must know when your stocks have earnings. Market thoughts. Nice week in the market as the emergency. And the things that have changed, I made yell. Doha meetings, failure was a non-factor. It's funny, as I showed you last week, I bought a bunch of ERY, a contra ETF to energy, 3X. And I was feeling pretty good about it until I woke up in the morning on Monday and I saw that oil was starting to move. So I covered for a teeny gain at the open and went extra long on energy because this has got to be a bullish factor for the market when OPEC and Russia and Venezuela can't agree to cut production. That suggests to me that, and the prices hold and go up, prices are going up. We continue to have mixed economic factors and a setting of strong employment. No rush to raise rates anywhere in the world in the absence of inflation. Major market indices, as I pointed out several times, are at resistance. EPS season in high gear this week. This has been typically a seasonally strong time, but it's only a matter of weeks before that lovely sell in May looms in the traders' hearts and minds. And we're going to be watching closely the NASDAQ 100 and the canaries for a signal. A breakdown in the NASDAQ 100 at market resistance probably tells me we got to move down. So I'm going to be watching. I'm not anticipating. I'm not making decisions based upon what could, should, and would happen. I'm going to wait and see what happens. Here's my market meter. I do this on a daily basis. It gives me a sense of change day to day. Here's week to week, and you can notice that we started to get some weakness on the daily, where you got a mixed red and a buy on the NASDAQ, and then you've got the blue buys on the Dow and the S&P 500. Weekly and monthly are still strong throughout, and the Russell's really picked it up of late. Sector rotation, technology, staples, and utilities have gotten much weaker than they were last week. Materials still quite strong. Financials got stronger, and healthcare got stronger. So financials, materials, healthcare, energy still looks good. Industrials weakened with the blue bars coming up here, and I'll mention what these are in a few minutes. Tonight's agenda, after my introductory presentation, I'll do my top-down review, do some bottoms-up work, and do my charts of the week. I like to start with the prior week's charts before I go forward. The charts of the week are something I started about 6 months ago. They are presented for educational purposes only. Trading, especially options, which I often trade, carries substantial risk. I do not warrant any expectation of return, and I may or may not already have a position in stocks or options I present. I typically take the trades that they execute, so it makes it easier for me to discuss on the following session. I'm doing this not to provide stock tips, but to openly discuss how I take the trade, why I chose a specific stock or option strategy, and where I plan on taking profits or placing stops. So, 2 weeks ago, we picked Devon Energy. I picked Devon Energy, weekly high close doji, which is my favorite signal from John, by the way. Massive OBV move on the weekly, daily OBV going up, had gapped up some. I set my buy point above the high of the day on from this day here, which I guess was the 8th. The subsequent week, this is where I took the trade. We filled, I guess, 2 days later. And the purpose of this slide is showing you this is the fill point or my buy objective. This red is my initial stop, by green is my first target. So we have met the first target. We met it this week. And when I meet the first target on this trade, as I projected, I would raise my stop to break even and take off half of my position. Why? Because now I can't lose. Barring a major gap, I will make money on this trade. And in this market of volatility, I take off some on a one-to-one basis. Last week, I picked Encana, which is sort of stupid, I guess, because I picked an energy stock when I knew Doha was meeting, and I thought Doha was going to fail enough that I had a contra ETF as protection. So I picked it for a number of reasons. I liked the technicals up here. It was in a squeeze. Recently had a couple of kahunas. Broke above the 200. I like to see the retest, and I basically said, if I can close above this doji, I want to go long. So this was the basic pattern. Here's the doji. Let's see where I'm getting. Yeah, the doji's bar is here, somewhere around where my arrowhead is. I set buy in here, target and stop. And I took the trade, and here we are. This is the doji. I would take a buy if it closed above it, which was this day right here, where my arrowhead is, which would be Tuesday. It moved up, and on Friday, I took out my one-to-one target, and I took half off and raised my half to break even. By the way, this was an 8% move. Plus, because we blew right through my target. So those are two good trades, and we'll talk about this week's chart of the week in a little while. And actually, there's two. All right, I've been updating my data while we've been doing this. Excellent. So first thing I like to do is jump into TradeStation, which my scanner is working. Let me just set one more thing up to work. I have a number of pre-built scans that I've gotten from various sources or created myself. and I run them on a regular basis. I don't use this computer except for the videos, so I always have to update everything when I do it. And the only reason why I have to do this is because the resolution on my other machines are 4K, and I have to play games with it to make it work, and it's not clear. All right, actually, I want to stay in TradeStation. So let's go to my market force and divergence, and let's take a look at indexes. Let's look at the NASDAQ. So here's where the blue comes from and the terminal and the buy-sell signal. I'm going to look here at several different things. The first thing that comes to my mind are these green arrows, or in the case of a bad market, red arrows. Try to move that arrow up so I can see it better, but I'm not having much luck. There we go. All right. So, person PPS sell signals a red arrow, PPS buy signals a green arrow. Simple. This is a daily chart, this is a weekly chart, this is a monthly chart. I put a thing called the Elder Impulse Indicator on the price bar. If it's green, that tells Elder, as he teaches it, the buying window is open. I can either be holding or buying, but I shouldn't be going short. If the candle is red, the selling window is open. I should be short or holding it. I should not be going long. And if it's blue, then both windows, buying, selling, or holding, are open. So I'm looking at the color of the paint bar. I'm looking at the signal. And then I'm looking for the absence or presence of little dots that call out some MACD divergence. So we start with the NASDAQ. It's in a buy signal, but notice we went red on the paint bar. Buy signal here. So it's still in a buy signal multiple time frames. Clearly a pullback here. It's held at this level multiple times before. Let's see if it holds here and bounces on Monday. Dow Jones Industrial. Here's those little red dots. These pop up when you've got divergence. I think we talked about it last week. But this is real. And divergence often is a clue before something is going to change directions. So let's look at a couple of a trend line. Clearly, we made higher highs here. I don't think anybody could disagree with that. But then we look down here at the MACD divergence. And you can't disagree that that's not going the wrong way. So less pressure pushing this market up. We're still in a buy on all three time frames. We've gone to blue on the daily. Everything else is green. That's on the big stocks. Let's go to the S&P 500. S&P 500 looks strong, gone to a blue on the daily, but other than that, we're green everywhere else with buy signals. Let's look at the NASDAQ 100. So look at the NASDAQ rolling over, really being led, I think, by the NASDAQ 100. Don't know why that does that. But red arrow to the downside, red stock bar. So clearly weakness on the daily and the NQ100s. Still in a buy on the weekly, but it's turned blue. And interestingly, we're not in a buy on the monthly, although we got a green bar. So the NASDAQ 100 showing some weakness. And then lastly, let's look at the IWM. And you could see the Russell, as I said, has really had a big move. Notice the green dot here that was telling me that we had divergence convergence where the MACD was actually higher and the price was lower on the stock, propelling us much higher. Now I've got the divergence dots. Often we go for a long time before it changes anything, and it's still full-fledged green arrows up and green paint bars. If I look at very quickly, materials still look strong, green, green, and green. Little MACD divergences going on. Energy. Also strong, green, green, and green. Financials, little divergences popping up here, but buy signals in green throughout. Industrial, starting to get a little weaker. Here's your divergences showing me. You got blue bars here, so a little weaker than green bars, but still in a buy. Blue on the weekly, but in a green bar, green arrows, daily, weekly, and monthly. Technology, part of the NASDAQ 100, clearly rolled over this week. Two red bars and a red arrow. Red Arrow down on the weekly. So technologies were Staples, which had been a big leader in this market, seems to have rolled over for the last several days. And we had the MACD divergence on the weekly and on the daily before the market turned. You got arrows down, you got red, you got arrow down in blue, arrow up in blue. So technology or Staples have weakened. Utilities had weakened, and then they had a good day on Friday, but you could see arrows are down with red, arrows down with red on daily and weekly. Healthcare, green arrow up, green, and green. Healthcare is one of the leaders. And discretionary, not as bad as Staples. We have sell signal on the daily with a blue bar. The weekly and the monthly look fine. So clearly we've got something changing with materials, energy, and healthcare picking it up, and industrials, technology, and Staples look awful. Utilities don't look so good either, at least as of last week. So now it gives me a sense that the market's rotating because those Staples had been a big winner, as have been utilities. So let's go into the designer. Let's take a look at Major Markets Plus. And we're going to rank these for price and volume. Those that have price and volume, go top-down analysis. And this is going to put the things that had the biggest move up in the last one day, greater than 1 week, greater than 3 weeks from a weighting perspective. It's all price and volume. First thing I see is that the leadership is small and mid-caps in the NYSE, which has lots of energy and oil, gasoline, and there's biotech. What's been lagging volatility, NASDAQ 100, which I guess is also pulling down the NASDAQ, gold, the S&P 100, and the S&P 500. So that's a change where big stocks have been leading. Let's take a look at some of these. We know the only one with a kahuna in the last day was the NASDAQ 100, so let's just go to a clean view, and we'll start you off with a couple of different things. This is a my typical chart that I look at indexes with. In red here, I have a 200-day moving average. In blue, I have a 50. In green, I have a 17. This dashed here is an 8-day exponential, and this is a 1,000-day moving average, if I'm correct. Let me just double-check. 1,000-day moving average. Okay. So if I bunch this up a little bit, you'll see what my concern has been, that we are getting back near the previous highs. So I've drawn a lot of trend lines, and the question will be at the end of the day is, where are we going to stop? We're heading back towards a double top is what it looks like. We had to pull back a couple bars, sort of a, hanging man. It's not really a hammer, but a doji with a bottoming tail on Friday. If I had to guess, the market goes higher from here. At some point, it's going to stop. Let's take a look at the Dow Jones Industrials. Less technology driven. And you could see it's now made it up to that area of the double top. So let's just tighten this one up a little bit and see. So you got perhaps here's your next level of opportunity, but you are getting extended. You've had a big run. How about the NASDAQ composite? NASDAQ is above the 17, multiple narrow range bar days, sort of looks confused, taking a breather, maybe it's a pause to refresh. I do believe it's still going higher, sitting above the 17, which is above the 50. But whether it gets to 5170 or not remains to be seen. And then the Russell has had the biggest move over the last couple of days, last week or so. And you could see that the Russell is still has a long ways to go, but it's finally caught up to its 200-day moving average. Not only catch up after a couple days of stalling, it broke above and held. All these charts, I think, look extremely bullish and hopefully continue moving up. I guess if I wanted to be concerned about something, it would be this guy. And reality is we had a pretty big pullback here. We still stayed above the 200-day moving average. We had a doji. Wouldn't it be nice to see a bar up here and have a little high-closed doji and go back off to the races? But Jury's still out. We've got a lot of support here in the 50 and the 200. Obviously, the concern would be, do we break down below those, which should be at least short-term some support. Just play around here and do some trend line work. Yeah, I sure hope we stop here, because if we don't stop here, we have some support probably around where the site of this cross was. And if not, we could come all the way down and test this low, which we don't want to do. So NASDAQ 100 shows a little bit of concern. Take a look at the dollar. I mentioned it stabilized a little bit this week, and you could see that the dollar, here it goes, bounced up Friday, Thursday, Wednesday, Tuesday, Monday. So pull back on Monday, to Tuesday, and then 3 days in a row with positive closes. This is the Bongo weekly, still in a downtrend until proven otherwise. Take a look at the VIX. As we said, VIX has been down about where it likes to base. And then if the dollar is strong, then that tells me gold's probably going to give back some. Gold has had a great run. There's a spider. You can see it's pulled back below the 50-day moving average. That's bothersome. Silver has been stronger than gold of late. And silver still well above its moving averages. So as I look quickly at this, I would say strength. The Russell looks the strongest. The NASDAQ 100 looks the weakest. The other guys don't look like this is over yet, to be honest. But all it takes is one or two good days to change that. Industry groups, we have 171 in HGSI. I like to look force index 2-day EMA up. This shows me 74 groups with momentum to the upside. If I look to the downside on the 2-day, not the 5-day, I have only 4 to the downside. Ag chemicals, apparel, footwear, internet media, and precious metal mining. But to the upside, we've got quite a few groups. And what I typically do is I create a watch list by looking at the top 10 out of the top stocks of the top 10, and I only look at stocks above the average of the group. Expiration. So this is one that I own already, which is Southwest Energy. So I'm going to take this moving average chart that you get, and I'm going to make my crazy chart. So what happens here? Up here are my Bongo weekly and daily. These are a timing mechanism. I like to be long when the weekly Bongo is green. This is ABCDE accumulation. The greener it is, the more A it is. 13 and 2-day force. Then this is my high jump, which we're not talking about today. This is a red candle high and a green candle low. And then three signals, the open white bar, that would be if there's a Bible gap up. Then the mustard is a squeeze. That's a MOBO breakout. Here is the index group of the index of the group. Same moving averages. Added a PSAR reversal system there. I don't pay much attention looking at this on these calls, looking at relative strength versus S&P. I'm going to shut that here. I've got on balance volume right here versus a moving average. And so Southwest would be on my buy list if I didn't already own it. OBV is strong, everything's green, breaking above the 200-day moving average, what's not to like? So I would go quick, and I would go into here, and let's just put this on my trading tools. We'll just use Friday. Whiting Petroleum, Hess Corp, it's already broken out and run. Here's the other one I liked. I'm a little nervous about the 200-day moving average, so I'm going to have to watch that. Don't like the earnings per share. This is the revenue. This is a $8 to $10 billion company in sales. One of the big ones, Anadarko Peat. It's had a nice move off the bottom. We'll show it and throw it in the same place. Devon is one I'm already long. Marathon is another I'm long. Murphy, I'm long. I'm heavily into energy. That's why I bought my ERY. I did lighten up a little bit before the weekend, but I have a number of these small expiration stocks. I bought them all for the same reason. This is why I bought them. Take a look at Southwest Energy. I got into these stocks because they have big movement of on-balance volume and either PPS buy signals, or in the case of Devon Energy, a high close doji with up moving OBV. These are one of my favorite signals that I get in with John Stuff and TradeStation, and they all fired in energy. Yes, I'm overweighted. Yes, I know that's risky. That's why I had hedges like the ERY, and that's why I take profits sometimes on Friday and go back in on Monday with more. So I have a number of these already. That's enough of those. So let's shut that down, right click, back. Let's take a look at oil and gas services. A lot of drillers here, again, more beaten up stocks, and one of these is my chart of the week. ESV makes money, big downtrend, you know, is a bottom in. That's the play here. The play here is if you believe a bottom is in. Ensco. Here's Core Laboratories already breaking out. Halliburton's got earnings on Monday. Rig, lumbering around. Rowan broke out above the 200. That actually looks pretty good. Weatherford, we'll come back to this one. Hint, hint. Noble, like this one even more. It broke above the 200-day moving average. All right, back, diversified banks. Bank of America back above 15. We looked at some of these last week. Big run up, resistance coming, doesn't pay much of a dividend. Wells Fargo, I liked last week as well. Pays a 3% dividend, has a bigger way to run, kind of, sort of. We'll put that on the list because I think banks are a place I want to be. Midstream, these are big dividend payers. They've gotten hammered. Same pattern has been showing up on the stocks. Here is NGL. I don't like the look of that candle. Crestwood, you notice anything about these stocks? Two things. They've been destroyed. They bounced off the bottoms. They look like a bottom is in. And they pay huge dividends. 9.8%. Williams Company, 13%. Targa Resources, 9%. Enterprise, 5.7%, is broken above the 200-day moving average. Williams Partners, 11.7%. Probably worth having one of these. I mean, the challenge is, I think Barron's has something about either this week or last week. They're not without risk, and they've gotten hammered, and if interest rates continue to go up, they may suffer. Semiconductors, despite having a tough day in tech on Friday, several of these made the list. Here's an interesting one. Qualcomm, an old name, has to get above that 200-day moving average, but a mobile breakout from a squeeze. Everything is green. Big kahuna popped in, and this was one that I was considering for a pick of the week. Maxim, Marvell, Cypress, so far like Qualcomm, the best of the group. Back, biotech. Remember biotech. So, Sarepta. Person and I had the same recommendations on this. I owned this off of the bottom. They have a FDA committee meeting this week They put out briefing papers on Thursday, and the stock got hammered. I'd already had some profits in. I took half off the table, I think on Wednesday or Tuesday, because I, just like earnings, I knew what was happening from a calendar. I sold a call at 25, and I bought a put at 21, and the stock dropped down to about 10. So my $21 put will save my bacon unless this thing recovers. Now, I made money on the put. I made money on the call because the call premium's gone down to almost zero, but I lost money on the stock. Had I not done the collar, and by the way, the call paid for the put, I would be out a shitload of money. So you have to know when there's major news events. A reason to not play biotech is they have releases all the time in publications and data and major meetings. They have conferences, and then they have earnings reports. This will be interesting. They still could get approved. I highly doubt it, but if they do, it's a $60 stock. Right now, it's a bet. I'm done taking bets with my money. Biogen kind of looks like an oil stock here off the bottom. It's going to have to get through that 200. Everything is green coming off of Kahuna and a mobile breakout. Concordia, I'm going to skip this. This is up on where the Blackstone might be buying them. BioMarin, been in a downtrend moving up, also on potential acquisition news. Gilead's probably been the best performer of the biotechs of late, breaking above the 200. Everything is green. They better announce an acquisition soon because people are wondering where their earnings growth is going to come from. But this looks good from a stock perspective. Celgene, not quite as attractive. Still has to get above the 200, but trying to make its move up there as well. Intercept had a recent approval of a drug or a positive committee. Bluebird Bio, nothing going on. You notice these stocks are all beat up. Kind of reminds you of energy, doesn't it? We're coming back here in a few minutes. Infrastructure software, software as a service. A lot of these are, several of these are protection software, antiviral, anti-phishing, security. So ServiceNow earnings came out and gapped. Bible gap up, retesting at the 200. VMware, nothing. Palo Alto, probably the leader in security, struggling at its 50. Is it ready to move? I've got a lot of overhead supply here over the last couple of weeks and a lot of moving averages. I think I'd pass on it for now. FireEye, another defense stock, beaten up. Looks like it's trying to put up a bottom. So this could be one of my get-on-a-plane trades if it blows through the PSAR dot. Did have a Kahuna. Didn't make my cut list this weekend, nor did Proofpoint. A little bit nicer in the pattern. Has to get up above its 200. Did have a Kahuna this week. So I just go through the leading industries, banks. These will be a lot of regional banks. They benefit if rates go up. SunTrust, Comerica, they're talking about a sale. U.S. Bancorp, KeyCorp, they all got the same pattern. BB&T, they're right below the 200 or breaking above it. I mean, I couldn't figure out which one to buy, so I just added to my KRE position, which looks just like the stocks because it's a regional ETF of a bunch of ETF of regional banks. All right, so number 9 is Specialty Pharma. So Valeant, you know, if this thing starts to go up, it'll probably pull the whole sector because it certainly pulled it down. The big issue here is that Valeant is talking about hiring the Perrigo CEO, and that was very well received by the market. It doesn't look like much, but it did have a one-day movement, as you could see here, of 7.9%. I do point out it's relative strength of 1, so it's coming from the bottom. Endo popped, Mallinckrodt, Horizon, Relipsa. Jazz, actually the leader here after earnings, has had a nice move, cup, handle, breakout. If biotech recovers, these guys come up as well. And lastly, communication equipment. Just look at these real quick. F5 networks. Still got to get above the 200. It's, you know, this is what happens when 90% of the stocks end up below the 200-day moving averages. Most things got to fight their way up. Roof strength is turned up. Everything's green there. Mobile breakout in Kahuna. F5 looks kind of interesting. Juniper Networks and Arista Networks. They're all too low in the pattern for my taste. So that's the top 10. What I typically do is then I go and I look at those stocks in various ways. So a couple of the things I really like about HGSI is I could scan for certain things. So I like to scan for stocks that are sitting right above what I call free parking. So these will be stocks that have right above the 50 and have some momentum. You know, this is too tight. Let me give it 2% range. So I'm looking for stocks in an uptrend that have pulled back to support and have momentum come in. Too loose, but you notice it's sitting on the 50, and this blue thing here is a Kahuna. Kraft Heinz, sideways, Weingarten Realty. Uptrend, pull back to support, a bounce with a Kahuna. I would probably put that in the look at more. Allegion, too sideways, but it did pull back to support and have momentum come in. I'm looking for things that have a little bit more of an uptrend before that's happened. Sometimes you find them, and sometimes you don't. Southwest Gas, a utility. As I said, utilities pull back. I like buying things off support, 2.5% dividend, pull back to the 50, had a Kahuna. It would probably be worth looking more at this. Remember I said utilities were rotating out, however. All right, one of my other favorite scans is to look for my get-on-a-plane trade, which are PSA reversals close at a squeeze. So I see a couple right there I like. So to get in this scan, it requires that your stock, let me go back to the scan parameters. You have to be in a squeeze, and your price has to be right below the PSAR dot. Why? Because that gives me a very good objective price point to go through to trigger a buy signal. It's a Wells Wilder PSAR is a trading system that people actually use today. So other people are jumping in with me. The fact that I'm in a squeeze tells me I'm basing. And so I have something I could say, all right, Dycom Industries. I'm interested in getting into Dycom if it breaks above that PSAR dot. Closed at 67.98. The PSAR dot is at 68.43. So I might say if the stock trades above 68.45, go long. Looking at this, I'd probably put my stop at the bottom of this bar, which is at 66.10. So go long at 68.45. Let me just look at this. The 17 is at 65. Probably put my stop then right below here. 66.10 was too tight. Probably put it at 65.25. So go long if you go above 68.65. Put my stop in at 65.25. Get on my plane, forget about the trade. If I get filled, I automatically put my stop in. And if the market tanks before the market opens up, I won't get filled. So Dycom looks good. Home Despot, lower left, upper right, pull back to some support, held on Friday. Mobile breakout from a squeeze, I like that one. Already own it, but I still like it. All right. There are a number of pre-built scans. If you go into the smart groups, and I'm not going to do that tonight, but if you went into the smart groups, you could look at, under my name, Stocks 3X Big Volume. You could look at Mobo Breakouts, some of the best. Boston Scientific, this was a stock pick about a month ago. It's had a great run over the past month. We took it here. Here's Home Depot again. Here's that pullback to the 50 with a kahuna. These are stocks pulling back to the 50 with momentum. And here's that get on a plane trade. All right, so I have done my homework. Have you done yours? Probably not, it's only Saturday. These were the stocks that made my buy list. So I thought I'd start by showing you those. And then I'm gonna look at several of them real quickly, show you what I liked about them. And then I'm gonna finish with my two charts of the week. So you will have seen many of these stocks already. Picked a lot, 51 stocks this week. So a couple things. This is the warehouse view in HGSI. It includes both technical factors as well as fundamental factors. It tells me, first of all, almost everything's in a long-term uptrend. The only thing that's not in a long-term uptrend was one of my special case frontline, which pays a big dividend. Most things are in a shorter-term uptrend as well. Most things are green and accumulation distributing. A couple of them are intermediate. Nobody is a D or an E. So I'm picking the best of the best. If we look at what industries are represented, you see there's some banks. There's some number of exploration and production. Healthcare facilities, a couple of biotech, infrastructure, marine shipping, must be something there, oil and gas services and equipment, a couple REITs, semi, specialty pharma. Okay, so that gives me a sense of where the money is moving. So I'll go through maybe the first 10 of these and then we'll narrow it down. LGI Homes, this is one of the smaller home builders or younger home builders. Deep pullback, sort of a cup and a handle, ready to break out. Everything is green, LGI. I don't know what to make of this. It's probably an error. HGSI relies upon a third-party vendor for earnings per share data. And when I see zeros, I blame it on the third party. Adeptus Health, this is one I'm also very interested in, and we should look at this in TradeStation as well. Adeptus Health, a deep pullback. It's starting to stir again. I'd like to see it get above the 200. Tons of demand coming in, great earnings per share growth despite the sell-off. And this is one of the ones that I liked as well. Five Prime is probably my favorite bullish-looking biotech, not necessarily the best buy point. Despite having to shut down some programs that had some very positive results, this, I believe, is a royalty payment, so don't make anything of this $10.63, but certainly a nice move in Five Prime. Rice Energy is another one of the energy stocks that I've dabbled in. Has broken out here, doesn't make any money, demand coming in. Dicom we looked at. HD Supply was a spinoff a while back from Home Depot. And this was a get on a plane trade on Wednesday that I took, and it broke out on Friday with a kahuna out of a squeeze. Everything is green. One of the few stocks who's got actually earnings greater than its multiple. Seadrill Partners is another one of these drillers. Ignore the 20% yield. I don't think they're paying a dividend now. Although I take that back, they did pay a 25 cents in February, which is down from where it was before, but the price is down as well. It's got some earnings per share growth coming back in. Notice that its sales are picking up, and the stock has got a long way to go. Here's your lottery ticket of the day, perhaps, SDLP, Seadrill Partners Limited, 20% dividend yield. I don't vouch for it. All I'm saying, it's an interesting looking pattern. And here's GasLog, one of the marine shipping stocks. I like this one a lot, breaking above the 200-day moving average. OBV looks strong. So one way to look at my stocks is just to look at with my routine charts. But what I found, the way to really solidify my trading is to actually look at those that are buys looking at John's stuff. And these here, these 12, were the finalists. Several of these we've looked at before. So let's take a look at them. Adeptus, I already told you I liked it. Had a high close doji on Friday. OBV's rocketing to the up. PPS buying the daily and the weekly. Coming out of a squeeze with all my other signals filing on the weekly. I like Adaptus a lot. It could have been my buy of the week. I'm skipping a couple. Chryso, oil and gas. Like where many of them were, a nice high close doji coming in here. It's already moved up too much, which is why it wasn't my pick. OBV is strong. Frontline I mentioned was a special case. Well, OBV broke above its moving average. It's going up as well in the daily. High close doji today with a buy signal, PPS buy on the weekly, and a PPS buy on the daily. This one I liked a lot. Oculus is another healthcare stock. Too high up in the pattern to count as a high close doji. Just had one on the daily. I like the OBV a lot. Here's that Seadrill Partners. Look at that OBV on both the daily and the weekly. Even something like UNG, a high close doji, OBV rocketing on the daily and the weekly, PPS buy on the weekly and the daily, high close doji on the daily as well. So let me get to the two stocks that I picked for this week. And I'm getting tired, so are you. Again, this is for educational purposes only, and I've already gone over this once. This is Weatherford International. So this is a energy, oil, gas. I believe this is a services stock. Yes. Why did I pick it? I picked it because I like the pattern here coming off the bottom. I love the group strength. Had some kahunas here, been a better thing to pick earlier. It's in a squeeze. All my technicals are green. When I look at John's indicators, I have a high close doji and a rocking and a rolling OBV on the weekly, coming out of a squeeze on the weekly. I have a high close doji, PPS buy in the weekly and the daily, coming out of a squeeze here with strong OBV. I like this pattern a ton. It's already moved a lot, so I had to take more risk. Long at 848, target 1928, stop at 768. I'm risking 80 cents a share, or about 9.5%. I can purchase 1,250 shares and risk $2,000. High close doji, huge OBV, coming out of a squeeze, rock and roll. The flyer, and I'm not sure how I'm going to play this one, but I'm going to play it. There's a lot of biotech stocks that are showing up on my review, and they all look crappy. Gilead probably looks the best. Five Prime, if it wasn't too far extended, would probably be the strongest of the bunch. This is LABU. LABU is a 3X direction of biotech. If biotech moves, this thing will rock and roll. It closed at about 37. Its 200-day moving average is at 82. It will do three times the movement of the IBB. So, dangerous to play because of that 3X. But if I truly believe that biotech has bottomed, this is high octane growth. Here's its pattern. It kind of looks like Weatherford. High close doji. Major increase in OBV on the weekly, PPS weekly. PPS daily buy, rocking and rolling OBV. I like it a lot. Here's my parameters. I'm risking $5 a share on this, so I can only buy 375 shares to keep my risk at 2,000 or less. Now, that's not a big position for me. So I took a look at options. You can't see this worth a crap. All right, so here's a number of different spreads. I'm sorry it's so blurry. It's the resolution of the monitor. I looked at two different expirations, May and June, and I looked at long opportunities. So very quickly, the first one on the lower left is if I buy the stock. If I buy the stock, my profits are infinite. My losses here are $3,751, which is the cost of the stock. So the good news is I can only lose $3,751. The bad news is uncapped profits, but big loss potential. That's if I buy the stock. Well, what if I just buy a call? all I can lose, in this case, is the cost of the call option. So, just check in on the computer that I can read. That's about $500 to control 10 share, to control 100 shares of stock. So I'm going to pay $5 a share, which, by the way, is about the same risk I took over here. So for $5 a share, I can control 100 shares. So I can spend $500 to control 100 shares. Since I could buy almost 400 shares, I could spend $2,000 to control 400 shares. The good news is I get all the upside. My maximum profits are infinity. My downside risk is limited to the $500 per contract. Each contract is 100 shares that I bought. If I buy four contracts, at risk would be $2,000. So I've defined my risk. I have unlimited gains, and buying a call is great, except I got to pay $500 to get that call. And you notice that here, the blue line, the P&L crosses the current price. This tells me I have to move the price bar equal to the amount of premium I paid to break even. Capital, uncapped gains, cap loss. What about just selling a put? That would be over here. So if I sold a put, I get to put in my pocket about $500. My entire gain, however, when I sell a put, is capped at the amount of premium I get, and that's it. As long as the stock trades below the current price minus the premium paid, so the price, as long as the price doesn't go above the delta between the price at the time plus the premium I get, I make money. If the price drops, I can lose money. So a short put says, I want the price to go up. As long as the price goes up, and even if it drops a little bit because of my premium, I make money. But I have the same loss potential, $3,000+ on 100 shares, as if I bought stock. The advantage of this one is I get money in my pocket, about $500 for 100 shares. The disadvantage of this is that I've capped my gain. How about those of you that want to do a spread? I'm going to combine buying a call, and I'm going to pay for it by selling a call at a higher level. So that would be a bull call spread. So because I have taken premium on my short call, my out-of-pocket is going to be only $185, but I've capped my gain at where the out of the money short call is, but I've also capped my losses at only the $185. So, and actually I have to pay $185, that's the risk I'm taking, and I can keep the delta between the two calls, which looks about $215. I don't like that either. So what I'm going to do is I want to buy the stock, but I don't want to tie up all my capital. So what if I buy a call, have all the advantages of buying a call, except it cost me $500, and I sell a put at the same price? Then I get this corner here. So if I do that to control 100 shares of stock, instead of paying $3,700 and risking all of it, I can buy this spread for $20 per hundred. So for that same $2,000, I can buy 10,000 shares. I'm not going to, because that's a big risky trade. So this is called a synthetic stock. Now, you might say, Jeffrey, that's really risky. And I would say it's the same risk graph as buying the stock. Just don't go crazy with how many option contracts you take. So I do a lot of synthetics. One of the things we'll talk about at my September meeting is how I let other people pay me for taking the trades by doing these synthetics. Now, I have what I call a chicken shit synthetic. And what I do in the chicken shit synthetic is I actually buy a way out of the money put down here. And that costs me a little bit of money, but it does this to my risk. So the higher price put, which I sell, pays for my call. And the lower price put insures me from a catastrophic loss, and it reduces my margin hit. So various ways to take the trade, and we'll spend a lot of time at my September meeting. The user group met last week. Thanks for those that attended. Anybody that's an HGSI user and owns John's Lifetime Indicators, whether it's for TradeStation or Trade Navigator, is welcome to participate. Lastly, just want to bring back up the fall seminar again. John will be holding it for 3 days, September 24th, 25th, and 26th. I'm going to do my HGSI Doc Unleashed meeting on the 23rd. Right now, it looks like the cost will only be $400, including lunch. If you're attending John's meeting, I'll give you a little extra discount. I'll do it for $300. I don't do these to make money. I do them to not lose money and to have the chance to entertain you, educate you, and just have some nice networking and friendship. So hope to see you in Florida. And on that note, I'm going to say goodnight. Obviously, futures aren't out yet. And trade safe, because I think we've got some volatility perhaps coming back. Watch the Canaries and watch the NASDAQ 100. Good night.